Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. This is the Progressive Commentary Hour. Today, joint esophagus condition, the idea that they're torturing a person, keeping him in solitary confinement, for exactly which crimes? If I remember correct, Julian Assange released over 10 million documents exposing corruption at the highest level of governments and corporations, and yet he has committed no crime. The irony of it is the American media has simply lost touch with what Julian Assange provided them with. The New York Times, the Washington Post, the Times of London, the Guardian, all of them have used his material when it suited their political and ideological needs. So if Julian Assange was exposing some of the conservative or Republican administrations or even someone like Barack Obama, they chose not to use what he did about Obama, but did choose what he chose to expose about the Republicans. So why weren't they equal in covering the issues, including those involving heads of their own party? That's a question we're going to be asking in our discussion about the truth in journalism and what is happening to the Democratic Party. My guest is Ray McGovern. He'll be speaking with us from North Carolina. Ray McGovern served as an Army intelligence officer and a CIA analyst for 27 years under seven presidential administrations, from John F. Kennedy to George H.W. Bush. Among his duties was preparing the president's daily brief, which was a one-on-one to President Ronald Reagan's most senior national security advisors. So if there was one person in our government, in all the different agencies, who knew what everyone else was doing, it was Ray McGovern. Since retiring, Ray has been a vocal peace activist and a journalist and helped create the Veterans Intelligence Professionals for Sanity to expose the way intelligence was falsified to justify war on Iraq and the Sam Adams Associates for Integrity Intelligence. And he also works for Tell the World, an ecumenical Catholic publishing house. Ray's opinion pieces appear in many leading news sources here and abroad. He holds degrees in theology and philosophy from Fordham University, also a background in Russian history, and is a graduate of Harvard Business School, and also has attended and graduated in theology from Georgetown University. His website is raymcgovern.com, and he also writes for consortiumnews.com. Nice to have you with us today, Ray.
Thank you.
Ray, you are a remarkable storyteller. You have been gifted with the ability of what we call in the South the gift of gab. But yours is not just random and nonsensical views. You are coming with an acute understanding of how foreign policy works. So I'm not going to ask you to focus on domestic issues. Rather, I'm going to lay out several issues with specific historical facts, and then in your own way, take each issue and then evolve it from your understanding with the context that we, who are not in the intelligence agencies, would not hold forth. All right?
That sounds good.
I want to take a trip back to Hillary and Bill Clinton, and then forward to Obama and Hillary Clinton. Dealing specifically with foreign policy and military issues, how they demonized Edward Snowden and have consistently opposed WikiLeaks' release of documents. Why? Also, the entire mainstream media, with no defections from the New York Times, the Washington Post, Boston Globe, the Miami Herald, they have all universally said that Trump was aided and abetted by Russia and Vladimir Putin, that somehow he is an agent, and that he was elected because of that influence, and that it was the Russians who hacked Hillary Clinton's emails with the DNC, and specifically John Podesta, who was her campaign manager. Now, if we remember, there were tens of thousands of emails, and the argument was that anything that came from those emails couldn't have been true, but they were. Julian Assange's WikiLeaks have never once been found to have given inaccurate information. But then, your individuals, meaning the group of retired whistleblowers and people at the National Security Agency, as well as the CIA, have analyzed, was there another possible outcome? Could those emails have been taken from inside the Democratic National group and then given to individuals who then gave them to join Assange and WikiLeaks? Because Assange has stated on multiple occasions he had no communications with the Russians, he received no documents from the Russians, and why couldn't we believe him? And yet that part of the scenario has been completely left out of any of their investigations. And yet these are all people who are capable of doing good quality research. And if we found that to be the case, I'm questioning, why wouldn't they? And why is this information important to decide what really happened to Seth Rich, the man who was gunned down, who my sources tell me was the person that actually worked inside there, was a Bernie Sanders supporter, and when he saw the corruption going on by those closest to Hillary Clinton to get her the nomination when it should have gone to Bernie Sanders, that Seth Rich downloaded documents, printed some documents, met in a park near Georgetown University, handed them over to a man who had been a former ambassador to Great Britain, and or was a ambassador, and he in turn got him into Assange. That's the story we have. And then, surprisingly, Seth Rich was gunned down. It was called a robbery, and yet nothing on his body was robbed. Jewelry, watch, and money. Everything was there. So that's the first issue I'd like for you to deal with. Please take us through what your individuals, who have a lot of experience, came up with when you did your research. The forum is yours.
Thanks, Gary. Let me start by saying that I've been watching things in Washington for 55 years now. That's a long time, and you see a lot of change. But the biggest, the most significant change, the one that dwarfs every other change, is the one that that shows that we no longer have, in any real sense, a free media. That is big. Now, that all our framers talked about the necessity of having information available to the people. The information that most Americans have available to them is one-sided and very often distorted. So your listeners may have a little cognitive dissonance in listening to me now, but let me start out with a bunch of facts that we know to be facts, and people can draw their own conclusions. You'll recall that Hillary Clinton immediately thought that Donald Trump was vulnerable because he thought it would be a good idea to have a more decent relationship with Russia. Can you imagine? What a crazy idea. A decent relationship with the other country that could destroy us. Well, it made sense to a lot of us who knew about how we worked out through rapprochement and détente back in the 70s and 80s. And we knew also that China was stealing a march on us with respect to relations with Russia, which is also a big thing. So we thought that was a good idea. But, of course, many of us objected to candidate Trump on many other grounds. And just to set the record straight, I think he should have been impeached years ago, not for fooling around in Ukraine, but let's say take the global warming. Let's take the little kids that are dying on the border in the South. Let's take all the constitutional irregularities that he is in. If you can't impeach him on those things, well, you have no guts. So that's sort of a little editorial here. Let's go back to the campaign. Okay, so Hillary's on record as saying Russia bad, and Trump sort of an asset of Russia. Why does he think that Putin is anything other than the devil, right? So what happens? Well, on the 12th of June, 2017, Julian Assange gets up and says, we have emails relating to Hillary Clinton, and we're about to publish them. She said, with their pending publication, end quote. Whoa, emails. Well, you can imagine the consternation among the Hillary supporters and the Hillary and DNC. I mean, after all, the convention, the Democratic convention, was not scheduled till the 25th of July. And here it is, the 12th of June. Oh, what were those emails? And we know what they were. I'll talk about that later. But anyhow, they had a council of war. And Hillary and her supporters said, you know, we can do about this because, you know, what will Bernie say when he finds out that we stole the nomination from him, that we skewered the primaries? That what's he going to do? You know, what are we going to do? We only have 6 weeks or so. Well, somebody said, well, I know, Hillary, we'll blame it on the Russians. And she said, now, I wasn't a fly on the wall here, but this is interpretation, right? She probably said, well, now, wait a second. It wasn't the Russians. It was WikiLeaks. No problem. We hate them both. We'll get a twofer. We'll say that the Russians hacked into the DNC and gave them to WikiLeaks. That's what we'll say. That'll work. Hillary looks around and says, anybody get a better idea? Well, there was no better idea, and they ran with it. Okay? What happens next? 2 days after Assange makes that announcement, a sort of an ambiguous figure named Guccifer II arises out of the ashes and says, yep, we know it was the Russians. I was working for the Russians. And here is some samples of email messages and intercepts that I had. You know, it was a crock. It was manufactured. We know that from looking at the metadata. So that's the 14th of June, 2016. On the 15th, CrowdStrike, which is this very, very dubious reputation cyber company that Hillary Clinton and the DNC hired to look at the DNC computers, CrowdStrike comes out and says, aha, Lucifer 2 is right. It's the Russians, and we have to stop this Russian attack on our systems. Well, they played that right up until Julian Assange released the emails, the DNC emails, on the 22nd of July, 3 days. Before the Democratic convention, and all hell broke loose. New York Times, Washington Post, Wall Street Journal. What were the headlines? Why did the Russians do this? This is beyond the pale. This is an attack on our electoral system. Why did the Russians do this? Yeah, it was a magnificent diversion. You know, the old book or the old movie, Magnificent Obsession? Well, this was a magnificent diversion of attention. Nobody at all looked at the content of the emails, and the content showed, and these were authentic. Nobody disputes the fact that Julian Assange, as usual, had authentic emails. These were authentic emails that showed what the DNC had done to restructure everything and prove that Hillary had stolen the nomination. And why do I say that? Well, one of the persons who saw that was Tulsi Gabbard. What'd she do? She quit. She was the deputy head of the DNC. And she said, yeah, I can't abide this kind of thing. And so she quit, and she worked overtly and very vociferously for Bernie Sanders. So this was very clear what was going on. Now, what happens next? Well, campaign there at the Democratic National Committee convention, PR person for Hillary Clinton said at a public meeting, her name is Jennifer Palmieri, it's on my website, what she said was, you know, it was really hard for us to believe this, but I went around in a golf cart around to all the outlets and the cable outlets, and I tried to show them that the Russians had hacked. And the Russians had hacked so that Hillary would lose. And you know, they weren't really interested. It wasn't really selling. But then, and this is a direct quote, when we got back to Brooklyn, DNC headquarters, of course, that were Hillary's headquarters. We get to Brooklyn, then intelligence sources came to us and filled us in on the details. And then journalists who were briefed by intelligence sources came to us and showed us the details about how this terrible hack was by the Russians and then WikiLeaks. And then, best of all, the Obama administration sort of confirmed this or that piece of information. Then we were off and running, and then we could prove, in quotes, that the Russians hacked to defeat Hillary. It was all a canard, Gary. It was the most transparent, if you looked at it closely, ruse that I've seen in recent years, and I've seen a lot of them. So that's how it originated. Now, when WikiLeaks came out and did that on the 22nd and 23rd, well, the rest of the time was all spent trying to exploit what Hillary thought was her advantage here, and that was to play this drum saying, look, Trump is going to be cozy with the Russians. It didn't sell. It didn't sell at all. And a couple of people probably read those emails. And then the email from Podesta, which showed that Hillary was in Wall Street's pocket. So what happened after the election when Hillary unexpectedly lost? Well, you know, it was PTSD. I mean, in the Nation magazine, in all kinds of Hillary support, they just couldn't. What set in, I like to describe as the HWHW virus. That is, the Hillary would have won virus. It could not have been, Gary, it could not have been that very few people trusted Hillary, or that she didn't campaign in the right places, or that she was seen to be in Wall Street's pocket, or that she was fast and loose with the top secrets of the United States government. No, it couldn't be that. It had to be something else. And the Russians were elected. Now, how did just one more oddity here that has to do with all this. How did the U.S. government find out that it was the Russians that hacked? The answer to that is, they didn't find out. Well, what do you mean, right? All the intelligence people, I said, yeah, right. All the intelligence people told us they were weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, right? Now, when this study came out on the 6th of January, 2017, it was represented by Hillary and others as the consensus of all 17 U.S. intelligence agencies. But it wasn't. It was a lie. And then they said, well, no, it's just three. That was a lie, too. It was by James Clapper, the head of National Intelligence's own admission. It was a rump study, not prepared by three agencies, but by what he called, quote, hand-picked analysts, end quote, adducing no information at all, and accusing Vladimir Putin of personally running this operation to hack the DNC. There was no evidence adduced. And when people said, well, we have the attack on the Democratic National Committee computers, well, what was wrong with that? What was wrong with that is that James Comey, the head of the FBI, for reasons that are about to come out, shied away from taking control of those computers. He didn't seize them. When he was asked by Congress about that, isn't it best practice to, you know, when people are accusing the Russians of an act of war, I mean, to grab the instruments there and have your people go in and look at what happened? Well, Comey says, well, yes, that would be best practice, but this CrowdStrike outfit is a super, super cyber outfit, and we decided to depend on them. Well, guess what? 2 months ago, we found out that CrowdStrike never gave the FBI a final report on their investigation, in quotes, of what happened at DNC. And James Comey was just as happy not to get a final report. And so all this business about CrowdStrike proving that there was a hack on the DNC is not only spurious, but in courts of law now, judges are ruling that Mueller, when he said Russia hacked, that he was depending on no tangible evidence at all. And things have been thrown out of court, or at least people have been asked to think about what the premise for all this thing is. Last thing I'll say is that we're getting to a denouement. We have this fellow, John Durham, a special investigator, who's now embarked on a criminal investigation. Now, his task was to find out how this Russia thing all started. There are big fish to fry here. I'll name them. James Comey, John Brennan, James Clapper, various officials at the deputy level in the Department of Justice. They are all in danger of being indicted, convicted, and spending some decent time in jail. Now, how do I know that? Well, I just sort of say this. So it's easy to understand if you think about it. Hillary was a shoo-in. Hillary was bound to win. Everyone thought that, okay? Now, did James Comey think that? He wrote in his book, and I quote, "I was operating in an environment in which we were sure that Hillary Rodham Clinton was going to be the next president of the United States," period, end quote. Okay, now, what does that mean? That means that in order to keep your job or to enhance or be promoted, you want to do everything you could to ensure that Trump did not win and Hillary did. Do you have to worry about violating the law? No, Hillary's going to win. What we would expect these people to count on would be promotions and praise and not indictments, for Pete's sake. They were so sure that they didn't even hide their tracks. I mean, they were doing this at a very high level, even perfunctory security measures to keep this stuff secret were not performed. And now the Congress, as well as John Durham and the Inspector General of the DOJ, have the evidence. So let me just wind up here on this little thing. The denouement, what is that all about? Well, Durham and the Inspector General, Michael Horowitz from the Justice Department, have the evidence, some of them felonies, that DOJ, the FBI, and the CIA were forging things, were coming up with things like the spurious Steele report, or dossier, and using that to justify warrants to spy on Trump's former associates. That much is clear. And the congressmen who have purview over that have that information already. And Durham has lots of other evidence of the games that were being played on the assumption by these people that Hillary is going to win. They were going to be praised, not indicted. Now, what's the denouement? It's coming to a head now. And the question will be whether President Trump and Bill Barr, his attorney general, John Durham, the special investigator, with power to indict, and then the IG, the Inspector General of the Department of Justice, Michael Horowitz, whether they will have enough influence on Trump to overcome his preternatural reluctance to take on what is called the national security state or the deep state. Now, when we've come close to this kind of denouement in the past, and people like the Republican deputy head of the Intelligence Committee in the House, Devin Nunes, when he said, "We're going to indict, we're going to send people to, we're going to refer criminal referrals to the Department of Justice," well, that was 4 months ago. That was 5 months ago. Whatever happened? When the president, President Trump, said, "Oh, year and a half, 2 years ago, the legislation requires me to release the remaining kept secret information with respect to the assassination of John F. Kennedy, and we're going to release that this afternoon." Oh, what happened? Well, this afternoon, the president gets up that afternoon And he says, I've been talking with the FBI and the CIA. They say we cannot release those documents. And so, well, we'll look at it again in 6 months. Well, that was a year and a half ago. I made a little note in my calendar. 6 months. I inquired around. What happened? Well, nobody's no one in the media took the note. Nobody in the media asked, well, where is that? Where is that? What are you going to do now? So what I'm saying here is Trump is afraid. He's afraid of the national security state. These guys are not going to take it very, very calmly. Brennan, Comey, Clapper have their assets. And the real question now is whether we have a president who will take on these guys. And, you know, the deep state almost always wins. And when you have a choice between Trump and the deep state, many of my liberal friends would prefer the deep state. You know, they cite CIA and they say, whoa, but CIA says, you know, I couldn't believe it. It's sort of like a 180 degree turn from the usual stuff. So it remains to be seen what's going to happen. There's reason to hope that Trump and Bill Barr seems very serious about this. But the question is whether the White House folks and Trump will say, well, you know, it's best not to take these guys on. We, you know, nobody indicts the head of the FBI. So we'll see what happens. But that's where it is right now. It's really, really getting pretty
okay.
Labile,
Ray,
as they said.
All right, let's just take a moment. I'm going to continue, but I have about 15 different issues I'd like to address, and I will do a second hour if need be, because I want to get this out, but please just try to condense some of your thoughts when you're answering, okay, so we can get through all this. I will add my own perspective, and that is that within hours of realizing they had lost, they already had convened a meeting with Hillary and her immediate in-group to try to go about creating the Russian interference at that point. So this was something they didn't expect. Now, I do not support what I consider virtually fascistic approach to life that many of the people on the Fox network espouse. However, when someone does do something that I see as legitimate, I'm going to acknowledge that. I've acknowledged Tucker Carlson on certain issues, not his issues on the environment, not his issues on the border, because to me those are just ideological, and he's aligning himself with his own base. I'm talking about when people do something good that informs us. And in this case, as hard as it may seem for people, this is one time Sean Hannity got it right. Probably the only time he got it right, from my opinion, but that's my personal opinion. Over 2 years ago, they began to report on the air of a attempt by a group within the deep state to obfuscate, to cover up, and then to malign Trump. Now, as you said, there's a lot of reasons Trump should never have been president. But had the Democrats been honoring their word throughout the last 40 years and not allowed the offshoring of jobs by the tens of millions that happened under Clinton and Obama, and how they've dealt with inner cities and the criminalization of drugs, the whole long litany that the Clintons are guilty of, then I believe that that she would have been elected, and that would have been a disaster. As bad as Trump is, and he is bad to the bones, nothing would have changed in Washington. She would have just continued giving all the contracts, supporting all the major industries, because every single industry supported her and her husband and Barack Obama. So we, the public, might not have had all the gaffes and all the foolish things that have been released, but nothing would have changed for the better, in my opinion. But here's what was revealed through John Solomon, a person I believe has integrity and is a journalist with The Hill, and Sarah Carter, and the lawyer that appears on there, Greg Jarrett, and many others, a husband and wife couple who are both former prosecutors. They have brought forward evidence that is startling, that shows that the people doing the deals with Russia were actually the Clintons, and getting 20% of all of America's uranium. That's a matter of fact. Also, that the people that were involved in that, the Clintons and the Clinton Foundation, received over $100 million to the Clinton Foundation. Also, the Steele dossier was paid for initially and instigated by the Clinton campaign, and then and the DNC. And then other people began to pile in and put money into it. And Steele, when he presented this, it was all false information. None of it was true. And yet, a top person in the State Department said this dossier that he is using to smear the truck is false. That information was given to the FBI. That information was given to the White House. So everyone in power knew that the dossier was false. And it was the dossier that was used to get the initial wiretaps. And that was through a FISA warrant. And five of those FISA warrants were signed as being accurate, that the information contained therein was true. That means that individuals, including Comey, lied and signed a false document to get wiretaps. That should be an indictable offense. And in any other circumstances, would be. But with the Clintons, I played a long tape, an hour tape last week. I played a tape the week before showing their corruption in Arkansas when he was attorney general and then governor for two sessions. And then how he was selected by Mrs. Harriman and Winthrop Rockefeller, the governor of Arkansas, and Fulbright, who gave him his Rhodes Scholarship, which he bungled and had to come back to the United States after sexual allegations of molestation in England on, I think it was either Oxford or Cambridge. I think it was Oxford, and he had come back. Everything about their background has been sanitized. No matter how hard the prima facie evidence, nothing sticks to them. So if you or I or anyone else engaged in the cover-ups, if they destroyed their hard drives, if they erased thousands of emails, if they took a private server into their own home where confidential and privileged information was given, that is a violation of the law. So all these laws have been laying out that she has been in violation of, and yet Comey cleared her, and there was enough information to indict her, and he didn't. So to your question about these professionals in Washington, there's a club, and it really doesn't matter if you're conservative or liberal. You're in a power group run by elites, and it's the Washington Consensus, and it lasts forever. It never dies. It's like cancer. So that's important. No one on the left is covering that story, and no one's covering the story of Haiti. Now, I've helped the Haitian movement. I was up there. I broadcast. I was giving talks in front of the Clinton office, where a group of Haitians, not a single member of the media covered, not one. And in Haiti, over $12 billion minimally was given for the relief. None of it trickled down, and still to this day. There are riots in Haiti today. But will you see MSNBC, will you see CNN go down there and speak with the people and say, what happened to all the money? Do you know where it's at? Well, I have a video of the president of the Haitian Senate, the top person outside of the president of Haiti, who is an American puppet, who says that it went into the Clintons' pocket for a development project at the north end of the island that had nothing to do with the earthquake, because it wasn't affected by the earthquake. And so they built a commercial city that was supposed to employ 60,000 people. It employed less than 3,000 people. But all the money started to go into there. And once again, the people who were getting their products manufactured there suddenly end up giving money to the Clinton Foundation. So the left has refused to investigate the Clinton Foundation, and anything that's been investigated and reported by independents is dismissed out of hand. So clearly, there's enormous control over the establishment. Also, the left historically would have been appalled to use people who had been the head of the FBI or CIA. And suddenly, when the investigation on Trump was being done, everybody praised Mueller. They forget his background. They forget all the things he's done. We haven't. We have a whole litany of what he has done. He is a part of the deep state. And yet not once was this part of his background examined brought to the public's attention. So please address this before we go forward, of how where you stand in Washington is directly related to how you continue to support the status quo, and don't open doors you shouldn't. Don't expose what should be kept secret. And as long as you do that, you can spend your entire life without ever having a real job, but being well rewarded by what goes on in the hundreds of thousands of people who are in Washington. You were there for a long time, so you have a front-eye view to it. So please share that with us.
Sure. First off, you mentioned that the DNC, the Democrats, and Hillary Clinton, and the law firm that worked for them were paying Steele. We now know that the FBI paid Steele as well. Can you believe it? Okay. So you have this ginning up of derogatory information, which even Comey said was scurrilous and unproven, and it's used to justify before the FISA court, that's the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act court, a warrant to monitor Carter Page, one of Trump's people. Okay, now that's felony. Who are the people that signed that warrant? There were four of them. Comey, McCabe, his deputy, Rosenstein, okay, and two other functionaries from the Department of Justice. Bunty was one of the name of the other, and then that woman that was afraid that that there was compromises on the National Security Advisor, she too signed it. So those people are felons if the law is pursued. Now, do I expect that will happen? Well, you know, you can't let the wish be father to the thought here. You have to keep a sense of balance. And one thing that does need to be pointed out is that they made it very clear to Donald Trump when he came into town, you know, early December, they already made it clear. And I'll just give you a little chronology here. On the 3rd of January, early January, I should say, on the 3rd of January, Rachel Maddow had Chuck Schumer, the Senate Majority Leader, on. And Chuck said, you know, Rachel, I want to tell you something about Trump. And Rachel said, oh, what would that be? And Chuck says, you know, I used to think he was a smart businessman, but my God, you know, what he's done is very foolish. He's taken on the intelligence community, and they have 6 ways from Sunday to get back at him. Very foolish. That's the 3rd of January. On the 5th of January, the Gang of Four, that is James Comey, National Intelligence Director, John Brennan, head of the CIA, Comey, head of the FBI, and the NSA person, briefed Obama. And they said, look, you asked us to do this study, and we've got a really great study because it shows that Trump would never be president if he hadn't had help from Vladimir Putin personally. No. Obama says, well, I'm getting out of here. I'll just let this go forward. That was the 5th of January. On the 6th, these same people appear at Trump Tower in New York. They're going to brief the president-elect. Now, they come in there, and they say, now, Mr. President-elect, we have this study that the intelligence community, a lie, has done. And it shows that, with all due respect, sir, the Russians really, really helped you win this election. You know, blah, blah, blah. And then Comey says, now, gentlemen, I have to ask you to leave because I want to discuss something very, very delicate with the president. They do. And he says to the president, now, Mr. President-elect, I don't know how to say this, really, but we have this dossier, and it's very scurrilous. And I have to say, it's not corroborated, but it's very, and it has you cavorting with prostitutes in Moscow a couple of years ago. It's just awful. And it's going to hit some of the press has it, just so you know. I just want to let you, just so you know. Now, Trump was not experienced to the ways of Washington, less still to what happens to a president-elect as soon as he gets into Washington. And so, he thought he could win Comey over and get him to be, quote, loyal to him, What he should have done, and what I would have done in the circumstances, Mr. Comey, go clean out your desk. You're not going to be around here for a minute after I become president. I know what you're doing. You guys do this to presidents all the time. You're acting like J. Edgar Hoover. Forget about it. Get out of here. That's what I would have done. I would have fired him on the spot instead of trying to cajole him into being loyal and then having to fire him many months later. So that's what was going on here. And that's really important to put into perspective, because the Steele dossier, even by formal testimony from Comey's deputy, McCabe, it was the keystone for the FISA warrant. So the question is, will the president and Bill Barr and the others have the guts, have the fortitude to say, well, this is the law here. They've broken the law. We have to bring them to justice. Maybe we don't put them in prison, but we try them in a court, and we make sure that this doesn't happen again. Again, I'm from Missouri. I don't think Trump has the guts to do that, but he certainly has the power to do that if he wants to take a chance of running afoul of the national security state.
Okay, I appreciate that. Now to the next issue. And for those of you just joining us, I'm Gary Nall. This is the Progressive Commentary Hour. And is Ray McGovern is the gentleman you're hearing from. I would like to deal with some specific foreign policies, because these also involve WikiLeaks and cables showing why we were really there, the control over assets and the gold denier and the taking the African nation, including many of the major groups in Africa, of which Gaddafi was elected to head, and take him out of the power of the hegemonic American, British, French, and Italian controls. In other words, having their own country and living by their own standards. But here you had Gaddafi, and no one in the media, no one, including many liberal media proponents of this regime change, using the same playbook as they did in Iraq, said that we had to go in because Gaddafi was poisoning his own people, shooting his own people. Now we, meaning Richard Gale and myself, did our own investigation and found nothing could be further from the truth. They said that it was a hotbed for terrorist activity. There was no terrorism. The terrorists were in prison. In fact, at that time, of the 54 countries in Africa, it had the longest life expectancy, the one that gave the most freedom to women of any Muslim nation. It was against the law to insult a woman in Libya, and they headed most of the democratic councils, the people's councils around the country, of which there were hundreds, even thousands. They made their own rules, and that the medical care was free, education was free. You wanted a house, you got it. If you were pregnant, you got a bonus there. The oil revenues went into a general account, and then it went to every member of Libya. Libya was considered the Paris of Africa. There was no crime. High standards of living by everyone. Now, that's the reality. And we've researched this. We've interviewed scholars. We've interviewed people who are living in Libya. And they destroyed it all. Not once have you heard a single person from the mainstream media, no one on the left, and especially MSNBC or CNN, say, shouldn't there now be an honest, independent review of what Obama and Hillary Clinton did in Libya, to see why they did it, who should be held accountable, and what international crimes did they break that they should be held in the same stance of justice as someone else who commits a crime against humanity. And it was a crime against humanity. Now you can buy slaves in open markets in Libya. There's people coming from other places to get out of Libya, to get out of Africa, and they had to go through Libya to get to Europe. They've been attacked and raped, and their organs have also been removed. There's a thriving organ market. So everything you could do to completely destroy a country, they've done. Not a single word of comment about these actions. Now, give us what you know about Libya, their need to destroy it, and how the American media are culpable for enabling that process and covering for them as publicists.
Well, Gary, in this case, NATO leaders were as much at at fault as Hillary Clinton. It's very clear, even Obama has admitted, that he went with Hillary Clinton's advice on that, against the advice of the Pentagon and other more sober-minded people. The ostensible reason was to run air cover so that people would not be attacked or people would not be terrorized. Well, Hillary Clinton and her people at the UN sold that to the Russians and sold that to the Chinese and said, please, please, we don't ask you to vote for this resolution, but could you just kind of abstain? Because that's all we're going to do. We're just going to fly over, make sure nobody gets killed. They agreed. To their great chagrin now, they got waffled here. So what'd she do? Well, you know the rest of the story. They finally found Gaddafi. They impaled him. They caught him in a... He had a horrible death. And what did Hillary Clinton say the next day? On air, we came, we saw, he died. A cackle, okay? So that was the attitude. She didn't know what she was doing. Obama didn't know what was going to happen. But the Pentagon, the CIA, certainly told him that if you destroy this country, it's going to be bedlam. And there is bedlam there, not only in Libya, but in the rest of Africa, particularly the countries just south of Libya. What did they do with the weapons that had been installed there in Libya? They sent them to Syria. That's what they did. That was part of the game, okay? So this business about Libya was really a bad idea, and it's destroyed a country. And, thinking about the Russians again, and this is where I have my expertise, Putin, he made a point. A year or two later, when he bailed Obama out, there was a false flag attack with sarin chemicals outside of Damascus. John Kerry and the others blamed it on Assad. It wasn't Assad. It was a false flag terrorist attack. So what did Putin do? He bailed Obama out by persuading the Syrians to give up their chemical weapons. Most of them were so old and rusted they couldn't even work. Give them up to under international UN inspection onto a U.S. ship specifically outfitted for the destruction of such weaponry, okay? That was done. Now, after that was done, and this was the highlight of Obama and Putin's relationship, on September 11th, the date is a coincidence, September 11th, 2013, there was an op-ed that Putin placed in the New York Times. Now, it said a lot of good things about what had happened, namely the avoidance of overt war in Syria. And then I'm reliably informed that he wrote the last paragraph. Now, I have it pretty much committed to memory. What it said was this: Mr. President, the only thing that I don't agree with you on is that there are exceptional countries in the world. The U.S. considers itself not only indispensable, but very exceptional. My view, says Putin, is that there are old countries, there are new countries, there are small and big ones. There are ones that have very little experience with democracy and others that do. But when God looks down at all these countries, he considers them all equal. And that's what I do. Yeah, wow. That's it. That's right. Putin is right. We have no claim on being the indispensable country in the world. And, you know, if at one time we were, and after World War II, I suppose that could be argued, we're not anymore. And so what Putin is trying to say is, look, let's keep working together. And the best thing for you to do is to stop thinking that you're indispensable or exceptional. Now, what happened? That was the 11th of September, 2013. Victoria Nuland, Assistant Secretary of State, who used to work for Clinton, and Clinton had just left, and the others mounted a coup in Kiev to depose the president of Kiev, who was friendly with the Russians, and install a puppet regime there. I mean, it was the most blatant coup in history because it was advertised on YouTube 12 days before it happened. I kid you not. So that was the way the neocons said, well, you know, let's do this coup in Kiev, and we'll give Putin two choices. One is to let it go and let Ukraine become part of NATO. And number two, well, he probably might more likely seize Crimea, since it's the Russians' only warm-water port, and probably support those poor Russians out, you know, Russian-speaking people out in the east of Ukraine. So what happened? Well, he chose to do the latter, and whoops, that was the end of the rapprochement, or the détente with Russia, because Putin was accused of invading Ukraine, attacking and invading Ukraine, and also he was accused of shooting down an airplane that there was no evidence that the Russians knew anything about it. So that got the West to make sanctions on Russia. That got the Europeans that never grew up after World War II to just sit back and say, okay, we're vassal states. The U.S. has sanctions, even though we can't sell our apples anymore. Well, we'll bend to what the U.S. wants. But the U.S. didn't suffer very much. Russia suffered not very much either, because they went ahead and developed their own resources. But the West Europeans suffered. And my question on that is, when will it be, finally, after 80 years or so, that the West Europeans will start acting like adults and not like children and look after their own interests? For these purposes, I would just say that was a critical period, fall of 2013, and then the coup in Kiev on the 22nd of February 2014, the downing of MH17, the Malaysian aircraft blamed on the Russians or the Ukrainian Russians, on the 17th of July 2014. Things went down precipitously then, and the people who have real interest in a bad relationship with Russia, like Victoria Nuland and others, the neocons, so to speak, well, they won the day, and it's been downhill ever since.
Okay. Ray, unfortunately, we do not have time to get to the most important question, so we're going to, in a moment, we're going to take a break and come back and do more, because I need you to give us a whole understanding about this. You've talked about Gaddafi. Now, WikiLeaks was the one who leaked the information showing that there was no threat by Gaddafi to anyone. And so destroying Libya had nothing to do with bringing peace and democratic principles to the people of Libya. The momentum for a pan-African economic renaissance, a pan-African currency, African Central Bank, was reversed to assure Western corporate colonialism continued. That's the reality. That's what was in their emails. And the person who was supporting that was Gaddafi, so he had to be ousted. And then you had to take a look, and it was America. It was under Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton and Nuland. By the way, you didn't mention who Gloria Nuland's husband is, who her family is. You want to mention that they're the most powerful neocon, pro-war group in America?
Yeah, I mean, they hate Russia from another picture, as we used to say in the Bronx. Robert Kagan is her husband. These are the folks that brought us Iraq. These are the folks that escaped any opprobrium for having manufactured evidence to let chaos reign, not only in Iraq, but in Libya, as you say, in Syria now, and God forbid, in Iran eventually.
Oh, they're going for Iran, and the media is completely complicit. And unfortunately, the world as we know it will really be in a boiling stew of constant terror if that happens, because that war won't just be a war on the ground. It's going to be a cyber war. And I can't imagine that Iran has not been planning on this since it was discovered several years ago that the United States and Israel had a system in place to turn off all the electricity in one of their malwares, and actually were able to turn off their centrifuge where they were making nuclear energy, and they turned them off in such a way that the Iranians couldn't figure out why all these thousands of centrifuges were exploding. And that was because the Israelis and Mossad had put that into their systems. So you can bet that Iran and Russia and China learned about this and then began to do things on their own. They could throw it back against the United States. So if people think there's going to be missiles come at the United States, I don't see any missiles come at the United States. I do see if there's a war where Iran is attacked, I see Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates being attacked using cyber attacks, also the United States and anyone who's supporting it on this side. But that's going to be discussed in a few moments. Right now, we're going to take a break because we're into our first hour, and we're going to come right back with Ray McGovern because my most important questions are going to be answered in just a few minutes. Please stay with us.
There's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Yeah. Father, Father, we don't need escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate. You know.
I'd like to welcome you for part two of our special in-depth interview with one of the leading voices for the peace movement in the United States, Ray McGovern. Now, he worked in the belly of the beast for almost three decades and has been in communicating with ex-intelligence agents at the National Security Agency. He's friends with all the whistleblowers, William Binney, and they all have concluded, first, that it was not physically possible for the Russians or anyone else to have gone in there and taken the amount of information out of the DNC, that the media didn't care. He also and others showed that there was no legitimate reason to invade Iraq. They didn't care. That when people were saying after investigations, including the inspectors, chemical weapons inspectors, there is no evidence of weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. They didn't care. So when it came to Gaddafi and saying that he was a threat, they didn't care. When it came to Syria, once again, even Democracy Now! And Amy Goodman, they supported this. When it came to defending the white helmets and actually praising them all over the media, including Democracy Now!, and Donald Trump giving him just this week, I think it was $5 or $10 million, nobody cared. When we showed with five separate investigative journalists who went to Syria that the white helmets were a terrorist group, nobody cared. When we showed that Assad was not responsible for the gas attacks, and several people, including Seymour Hersh, the great investigative journalist, proved that, nobody cared. So we got to understand, we're really engaged in cognitive disassociation of reality. So, Ray McGovern, in this segment, I'd like for you to go into a couple of issues. One is, Julian Assange was the one who told us about the truth behind all these, and no one cared except they panicked. Now they've gone after Julian Assange. Before I go further with Benghazi, what was the truth of Benghazi? We were lied to. We were lied to both left and right in congressional hearings and Hillary Clinton. All lies. They were covering the truth because the truth would have meant America was actually funding, training, abetting, defending terrorist groups. We helped actually cause the creation of ISIS. Turkey, one of our allies and a NATO ally, had hospitals that the President Erdogan's daughter was running right across the border from Syria. Erdogan's son was stealing oil from Syria and selling it for $20 a barrel to Israel and other countries on the black market. And Erdogan was allowing all of these thousands upon tens of thousands of mercenaries to go into Syria using Turkey Turkey has not been accused of anything. They've been held in good standing. Now they're not going to be because what they've done to go in and kill the Kurds. I'm going to ask Ray about that to explain to us what this is about and who those Kurds there are. And why can't people just leave Syria alone? It's Syria's country. Everyone's acting like it's their country. They've conquered a country or part of a country. Therefore, they have a right to military bases, a right to extraction. Syria, which is a sovereign nation, its oil for their own usage. My goodness, why isn't anyone in the mainstream media reporting on this? Why does it take Chris Hedges, Abby Martin, and others, Max Blumenthal, to tell us the truth of any of this? So I'd like you to take any of these issues. I want you to tell us about the truth about America and what we've done with terrorists, and then try, like Ronald Reagan, to make the Sandinistas, the Contras, I should say, freedom fighters, when there was nothing freedom about. They were Somoza's old National Guard, and they were terrorists. And yet he held them up, and the media held them up as being America, just like America's founding fathers. No, they weren't. So when the head of ISIS was just killed this past weekend, everybody thought, well, that's good. But what role did we have in the circumstances in Iraq when he was in prison for 5 years of creating him? And what did we do to fund terrorist groups, calling them the good terrorist? Well, there are no such things as good terrorists. Yet we, the American public, were fed this pablum that somehow there was a good terrorist. Ones that would kill you but wouldn't necessarily cut off your head. The insanity of how we were treated like children is appalling. And I challenge the New York Times, I challenge the Washington Post to go do the work that others like Miss Beasley has done and see what they discovered and then come back and with a straight face say that everything we're being told by the CIA and the National Security Agency and the White House to justify our continued involvement in regime change in these countries is legitimate. Those are the issues I'd like for you to address. And Julian Assange is now being held prisoner. He is in the process of dying. And I'd like to know what crimes he committed that were so so challenging that we would not give him an open, fair, and speedy trial so that he could clear his name and whatever evidence they have against him, bring it. And then let him bring his evidence, and none of that is being done at the moment. The forum is yours.
Thanks, Gary. Well, there's a lot to cover here, but let's just start with Bush Jr. being a disaster with the invasion of Iraq and the neocons ticking off several other countries that they had in their sights, including Syria and including Libya. Now, one of the things that is not ever stated in the media in this country is why we went into Syria. And people cannot really grasp what drives U.S. foreign policy in that particular area without realizing that it is Israel, pure and simple, that drives U.S. policy in that area. Now, you don't have to believe McGovern here. Way back in 2013, when it looked like Obama was being cajoled or forced or politically forced into attacking Syria overtly, not just by the CIA, overtly because of this false flag attack with sarin, the bureau chief of the New York Times, to her credit, her name was Jody Rudarin. She went in very early September to high-level Israeli officials and said, now tell me, what is your preferred outcome in Syria? And among them was Alon Pincus, who had been the consul general in New York. These are senior people. And he said, well, Jody, it doesn't really sound very good, very humanitarian, but our preferred outcome in Syria is no outcome. And she said, what do you mean, no outcome? And he said, well, as I said, it doesn't sound very good, but, you know, as long as Sunni and Shia are at each other's throats in Syria, not only in Syria, but in the whole area, let them hemorrhage, let them bleed to death. We see it, said Pincus, as a kind of a playoff game where you don't want either team to win or to lose. just like them go ahead and continue what they're doing, because as long as there's chaos in Syria, Israel has nothing to fear from Syria. Wow. Now, what happened? That was on the Labor Day weekend. By a miracle, I suppose the big editors were off in the Hamptons sipping martinis, but Jody Ruderman's article got on the front page, lead article on the September 6th, 2013, and there it is in all its glory to see. And if you want to understand why Obama and the others just can't, even Trump right now, I mean, he can't get out of there, it's because there's a terrific lobby, not only in APAC and places like that, but also in Congress and, more important, in the media. So all I have to want to say here is that without understanding the significant role that Israel plays, and they wanted us in Syria, they didn't want us to win or lose, they just wanted us to be there just to make sure that Assad didn't win and that ISIS didn't win, and that suited their purposes just great. Now, well, how do they look at it now? They don't want us to leave. Why are we not going to leave? Well, that's a huge part of it, and people need to realize that. People can't hear that on the major media. Let's see, what else? The Kurds. Well, you know, the Kurds, they've been a sorrowful example of how people can take advantage of the nation that doesn't have a nation state, but they know what they're doing. And, you know, if U.S. policymakers and the U.S. military didn't know how strongly the Turks feel about the Kurdish insurrection, and if they thought that the Turks would allow the Kurds to be right there on their southern border for any particular length of time, well, they didn't know any of the realities in the Middle East. Let me just add here a parenthetical remark. After John Kerry got finished working out with Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov, a ceasefire. It took him 11 months to work out a ceasefire. This was about September of 2016. Yeah, okay. So, the ceasefire. What happens? The U.S. military bombs the hell out of a Syrian emplacement that had been there for years, kills 100 Syrians, and the ceasefire evaporates. Kerry comes home. He's asked, well, what do you think about Syria? And he says, you know, it's the most difficult set of circumstances that I've faced in my whole public life. There's Kurd against Kurd, there's Kurd against Syrian, there's ISIS, there's everybody, ISIS, there's Jordan, this is Israel. I don't know. You know, it was very difficult to align what was going on there. Now, my question, of course, is who the heck told you that the U.S., no matter how indispensable or exceptional it is, could align those forces when those forces have not been aligned in any credible way for years, and the U.S. is the last person that's going to do that. So all I'm saying here is that it's a very complicated situation. We went in like babes in the woods, and, you know, John Kerry is very impressive when he speaks, but he didn't know diddly about the Middle East, and now there's chaos, not only in Libya, not only in Iraq still, and now in Syria still, and it's going to be interesting to see if Trump can make his will prevail and get our troops out of Syria, because it looks like the Pentagon and the Israelis, and there are a lot of very heavy interests there, the oil people, they would like us to stay.
Okay. Let's take a look at the coup in Paraguay to remove a democratically elected social reformer, Fernando Lugo, who supported poor farming revolution and prop up the people who have been down. And then in comes a pro-Washington businessman. His name is Cartes, a member of the small 3% elite landowners controlling Paraguay. And that was it. Bringing in to a once promising socialist reform in Honduras also, under democratically elected President Zelaya, by military coup, so U.S. companies like United Fruit and Dole could be certain to have bananas and pineapple at basement prices. the result, a Honduran killing field for journalists. They were killed, environmental activists such as Berta Cáceres, killed, social reformers killed, farmers killed, and their families and children killed. And that was all based upon the CIA, Hillary Clinton, and Barack Obama. Why is it the media will not touch that? And a lot of what we know about the killing fields in Paraguay and the killing fields in Honduras came from WikiLeaks. So they go after Julian Assange instead of going after the people who created these killing fields.
Yeah, well, you know, it's an old story. When the CIA was taken under the British wing there of MI6, and they said, this is what you do to when you don't want dictators or you don't want leaders who are going to help the people, like in Iran in 53, like in Guatemala in 54, this is what you do. Now, that's exactly what's happened in Paraguay and in Ecuador as well. Now, Ecuador, of course, was giving Julian Assange refuge, a political refuge in their London embassy. So what did the U.S. do? Well, they helped to orchestrate the removal of Correa, his benefactor, who was running out of office anyway, and put in a guy who promised to be just like Correa and turned around completely once elected and did the U.S. bidding. Now, in return for what? Well, talk about quid pro quos. He got big IMF support. He's got naval people down there to help out his own navy. And so Correa is out. This guy is in. And when the U.S. says, well, you got to get Assange out of the embassy there, he bowed, kowtowed, and said, all right, get him out. And as you probably saw, on the 11th of April this year, Julian Assange was unceremoniously dragged out of the embassy in Ecuador, the Ecuadorian embassy in London, and put in a max security prison where he exists to this day, barely exists, I might say. Now, why did he have it in for Assange? Well, you know, how much time do we have? I could tell you. Well, let me just hit on some points, you know. He exposed the war crimes going on in Iraq and Afghanistan. War crimes? Yes, war crimes. There's video showing the killing of 12 innocent people in Iraq during the so-called surge. We call it collateral murder, and that's what it was. We have the video. We have the voice of these Apache helicopter personnel gloating over the fact that they killed all these people, including two Reuters correspondents. So we have that. Now, when these emails and these other documents came out, they're all authentic, of course, because they came from WikiLeaks. Now, what did the military say? Oh, my God, he's endangering. Oh, there'll be people killed because of all this. Guess what happened? Carl Levin, who was head of the Senate Armed Services Committee at the time, said to the Defense Secretary, Robert Gates, give me a memo on that. I want to know about the bad effects that happened from these leaks. 3 weeks later, the memo came, and Robert Gates said, charges that Americans have been endangered or killed or maimed because of these leaks are, quote, significantly overwrought, period, end quote. That was the judgment of the commander in Afghanistan, the one in Tampa, Florida, the Defense Department itself. So it was a canard to say that these leaks endangered people. What did they endanger? Well, there was a bunch of leaks having to do with State Department cables. I'll just give you a for instance, as we say in the Bronx. Here's an example. There's a cable. It came out of Moscow, and if I've seen one Moscow cable, I've seen about 3,000 of them. This came out on the 1st of February, 2008. And what did it say? It said that I, the American ambassador, his name was Bill Burns, he was called in by Sergei Lavrov, the foreign minister of Russia, just kind of new foreign minister at that point, and Lavrov says to him, hey, Mr. Ambassador, do you know what Nyet means? Bill Burns says, I was a little nonplussed. I say, well, yeah, I know, isn't it? Lavrov says, look, we understand you might try to get Ukraine in NATO. Do you know what Nyet means? Nyet means Nyet. Because if you try that, there'll be a civil war. We'll have to decide whether we need to intervene or not. You don't let Ukraine in NATO. That was the 1st of February, okay? Now, Bill Burns, to his credit, reported that back to Hillary Clinton and in the White House, and you know, they all got the message. What happened? Well, that was the 1st of February. On the 3rd of April, NATO, at a summit in Bucharest, said Ukraine and Georgia will both become members of NATO. Whoa, that's a little embarrassing, all the more so since the first President Bush had solemnly promised Gorbachev that if he agreed to a reunited Germany, there would be no encroachment by NATO, quote, one inch more toward the east than Germany. Now there are 13 countries. There used to be 12. 13 plus 12 countries in NATO, and the new 13 are all east of that border. So what this showed, and this is documentary, right? What this showed is that the U.S. was well warned by the Russian foreign minister early enough to have trimmed their sails and say, well, look, you know, this is like maybe putting missiles in Cuba as far as the Russians are concerned. So let's cease and desist and let's not cause a big fracas over this. No, no. They went to NATO and they got NATO approval on the 3rd of April, 2008. Ukraine will become a member of NATO. Then you saw what happened in 2014 when they tried to force the issue. So what I'm saying here is that a lot of this thing was thoroughly embarrassing to the United States, and that was just the beginning of it. Let me just give you a couple more examples. One was that in March of 2017, Julian Assange announced that he had been given a treasure trove of documents on offensive cyber warfare that came out of a new directorate in the CIA specifically constructed to engage in offensive cyber warfare. Now, when you have a new directorate, that means several thousand people, okay? And what they revealed, these documents, was that this unit had developed really, really sexy weapons. One could take you could take control of a car and make it go 110 miles an hour and kill whoever was in there. Another worked on a TV that you thought was off but was monitoring everything went on in your bedroom. But now at the end of March, this is March 31st, 2017, Julian Assange let go of the crown jewel here of these cyber warfare techniques, and it was called Marble Framework. What did it allow the CIA to do? To penetrate, to hack into a computer or server, disguise who hacked in, and leave little telltale signs to attribute the attack to somebody else. They worked in Russian. They worked in a couple other languages, but, you know, Cyrillic left behind, okay? So, now, this was really, really explosive. It was just part of what Julian described as more significant information than all the documents that Edward Snowden brought out into Hong Kong. Now, I'll give you an idea of the scale, okay? So on the 31st of March, he announces this. Now, I'm just waking up on the 31st of March, and I get a call. This is RT. Can you come in right away? RT, wait, you're not even open yet. We have some really explosive thing. We'd like to get you on at 9. Can come. See, well, where would I come? Well, come to the Eurovision. Okay, all right. You send me the thing, and I'll see if I can do it. So I looked at the email. My God, there was. Marble Framework described. So here I am driving down the carpool lane all alone there into D.C. so I can get there in time, and I called Bill Binney, who, of course, is the expert in this kind of thing. And I said, Bill, what's going on here, this Marble Framework? He says, Ray, you wouldn't believe it. This has been under development for 15 years. It was being developed when I was there. It's a CIA NSA product, and it involves, get this, Ray, 700 million lines of code. Now, McGovern is you know, a history major, right? So I said, Bill, that sounds like a lot. Is that a lot? Bill said, look, Ray, can you still do multiplication? Multiply $25 a line of code by 700 million. You get an idea of the scope of this effort. Tell them that when you get on before the camera. The rest of the story is this. The New York Times, whereas it ran the stories about the TV that the deceptive your conversations, the taking control of cars, it must have asked the administration, well, can we talk about this marble framework? This is very explosive. The answer was no. So you never hear about marble framework, this ability to hack into other systems and misattribute the hack in the New York Times. Last thing here on this one, that was the 31st of March, 2017. Less than 2 weeks later, the CIA director, Mike Pompeo, got up and in a think tank, and he said, Julian Assange is a demon. Now, you know, I don't believe in demons, but I understand that that Mike Pompeo does. He said, he's a demon, and he's running a non-state hostile intelligence agency. Whoa. Well, that threw the gauntlet down. By then, they had worked out things with the Ecuadorians. They kept him in incommunicado, that is, Julian Assange. A year later, they dragged him out of the embassy in London. And I must say that it was one of the saddest times I've had, and I've had a lot of sad times in history, to see my friend Julian Assange, unkempt and disheveled as he looked, being dragged out of that embassy. And as a kind of a memento.
Now we, Ray, now we know that a Spanish intelligence security service had secretly and illegally bugged the entire Ecuadorian embassy. So every single thing that Julian Assange did, every person that met with him, including his lawyers, they filmed it and fed that back. So yeah. British intelligence was aware of that, American intelligence. Just think of this for a moment. Because of Hillary and Bill Clinton, their tag team match, one has the charisma, the other has the manipulative brain. You now today have 13.5 million people in dire need of humanitarian aid and a displacement of 4.8 million Syrians as homeless refugees. The death toll was over 50,000 children. That is strictly on Obama and the Clintons, yet the media will not hold them responsible. Something else the media won't hold them responsible for is Israel and its ongoing military genocide of Palestinians, particularly in Gaza. So the apartheid occupation and expansion of Israeli settlements into Palestinian land continues, fully supported by members of Congress. And today, the actual Palestinian landmass is a pittance from what it was at the time of the Oslo Accords. So consistently supported and advocated vetoes of UN resolutions that were critical of Israel crimes against Palestinians were the Clintons and Obama and Obama's ambassador to the UN. And also successfully supported the fringe neo-Nazi factions you mentioned in Eastern Europe and by backing a coup in Ukraine and to bring fascism back into the modern world. And this is a rebirth Ukrainian mobs called out Kill All Jews, which horrifies Russians. Well over 2,000 Russians killed so far. And yet you would never know who was on the right side of this issue. As you mentioned, they said Nyet, and which means no, but America had its own agenda, its own hegemonic plans. And during the Arab Spring, the Clintons and Obama supported, and Joe Biden, the fundamentalist pro-Western regressive parties and dictatorial sociopaths to take control in its aftermath. This included Tunisia, Egypt, Yemen, and Bahrain. And also, they supported the Patriot Act, consistently supported surveillance of the public and social media. They favored nuclear power and weapons. They supported the pipelines, and they were anti-environmentalists. They were anti-union. And yet none of this is ever brought up by the left. So the last thing on Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama I would like for you to discuss is Benghazi, because my sources and my research with Richard Gale shows that the reason that both the right and left lied and the reason that no one told the truth in those hearings was because it is a crime against it violated several international crimes when, after killing Gaddafi and taking over his arms supply, they took those arms supplies through the embassy, and which was not secure, and then they funneled them across to Syria and to Turkey and gave them to terrorist groups that they were supporting. So first, if they admitted this, they'd be in violation and contravention of several treaties. Secondly, they were supporting terrorist groups, and that would have made a lot of Americans question, well, if we have a war on terror, why is America supporting terrorism? Along with Saudi Arabia and Turkey, we were the three major supporters of terrorist groups, al-Nusra, al-Qaeda, ISIS, etc. And so all this was kept, the real reasons for being in Benghazi were kept off the table. But once again, it was Julian Assange and his WikiLeaks that informed us of these transgressions against any principles of decency and democracy. Your thoughts?
Well, Benghazi was a terrific setback for the free world to see what went on there. The ambassador, of course, was killed. Benghazi, of course, was a consulate or a semi-consulate, Tripoli, where it had been the capital, but it was strategically located so that they could put a CIA annex in there and help to transship this stuff to the people, to the moderate rebels, so to speak, in Syria. Now, you know, when you talk about Obama and you talk about Hillary, well, you know, they bowed to the what we used to call the military-industrial complex. Eisenhower really wanted to use military-industrial congressional complex because Congress was very much involved in this. But now we have a military-industrial congressional intelligence media complex. And when I say media, that means that none of this would work without the media being full accomplices in all this. So what happened in Benghazi was very clear. They wanted to transship this stuff over. It was Obama himself who, a year after approving all these millions of dollars going into so-called moderate rebels, telling a journalist, well, you know, there's no such thing as a moderate. This is a, what do you say, it was a fantasy to think there were moderate rebels. Well, yeah. Why did he do it? Well, because he felt that he couldn't countermand the wishes of the armed forces and the intelligence community. And he did the same thing on Afghanistan. So what we've got here is Trump sort of inheriting all this. Now, again, I hold no brief for Trump at all. But at least, you know, he's been trying to get out of these places, and it's been very difficult because every time he tries, somebody like a big retired general or some arms manufacturer will object. You know, I don't usually agree with the Pope, but when Pope Francis came and spoke to Congress and said in his candid way, you know, the main problem is the blood-drenched arms traders. Whoa! They all got up, and then he clapped. Oh, yeah. And then they looked into their vest pockets to see if the last envelope from Lockheed or Raytheon or General Dynamics was still there. You know, it was hypocrisy on steroids. So everyone profits from this kind of thing. Keep the pot boiling. The Israelis are delighted when we're engaged militarily in that part of the world, whether it's surreptitiously by the CIA or whether it's overtly in support of whatever, those 100 or those 2,000 or whoever it is to keep them in there. And, you know, it's not going to come to a good end because Iran is, you know, it used to be that Iran was the major supporter of terrorism in the world. But, Gary, that was 35 years ago. Now it's not Iran. It's Saudi Arabia. It's the people that the Saudis and the Turks support, and that we were sort of cajoled into joining and keeping the pot boiling in Syria. Now, Assad has consolidated almost all of his country. He's got the Russians who have been invited in, unlike the others, like the U.S., the Russians and the Iranians helping him, it's an open question as to whether he'll be able to consolidate his northern border. But if the Kurds do leave, then the Turks will have less concern about what happens on that border. It's conceivable now for the first time since 2011 that Assad can consolidate his control over the country. I don't know what kind of guy he is. But, you know, when people say, well, we can't, you know, he's got to go, or we got to invade him. I had a talk with the Turkish journalists, and I said, look, you know, there was something called the Peace of Westphalia, okay? Now, that's 1648, but that came after the 30 Years' War, where people in Europe are killing each other off at a horrific rate, and they decided there's a better way to relate. And that way was to have secure, sovereign borders. So, you Turks, you invading Syria, and nobody bats an eye? Well, you know, we've come a long way since 1648, where those borders were recognized, and the only real people that violated them were mostly the Nazis and others. And for us to sort of say, ho-hum, when the Turks or anybody else invades another country, well, it's a sad commentary on the retrogression here. The more so when we talk about Julian Assange and the Magna Carta, 1215? Okay, in that same century,
yes.
You know, those British nobles stood up and said, no, no, King John, you can't do these things. Well, my question is, where are the British nobles now? Where are they when there's a travel?
Good luck finding that. Mm. I'm glad that you made a rhetorical statement, because there would be no legitimate way of answering that. It doesn't exist, and nor in the United States. But what I believe from the people who have interviewed Assad, including Abby Martin and Beasley and some of the others, about five of them that I've spoken with personally, that he is a person that wants his country and the citizens of his country to live in peace. I believe that. His father, no. But they say that he's very accessible, as is his family. He doesn't have a gigantic security detail. He is a person of the people, and the people at least support him. And if I were him, I would reach out to the separatists, the Kurds, and I would negotiate with them to see if he couldn't, on humanitarian and political reasons alone, give them a section closest to the border, so that at least they could have a place without fearing retaliation, retribution. They could live there and create whatever community they chose to. That would be one idea. But now we shift over again, because I'm going to look at some of the things that happened that you may or may not be as up on. For example, the genocide by Paul Kagame, the president of Rwanda, where now it's estimated that nearly 2 million people died, not 930,000. And that is because Bill and Hillary Clinton and the UN ambassador supported a regime change there, taking the power away from the Tutsis and giving it over to Kagame, who will then use, as he has, exploiting that advantage in the Congo. Also, the Clintons regarded President Mubarak in Egypt as a close personal friend. They have stated that. And he received $1.3 billion in military aid annually. But he was a tyrant, still is. And 500,000 Iraqi children dying from sanctions, and that was Clinton's war. 500,000 minimally. I've also seen figures as high as 640,000 children dying, because Bill Clinton and the military advisors suggested that they have the people rise up against Saddam Hussein by creating an impossible situation for living. They bombed intentionally, which is against all treaties, infrastructure, like water purification plants so the children were drinking septic water and dying, and power grids, having nothing to do with the military. But they were never held accountable. They even bragged about it when asked by Leslie Stahl on 60 Minutes, was it worth 500,000 children dying? And Madeleine Albright said yes. Wow, and she's still power today. And also, the day before the impeachment vote, Clinton bombed Iraq. This forestalled the vote further and continued to do so while the House was trying to vote. and the Clinton humanitarian bombing, and remember they called it humanitarian bombing? What an oxymoron. That's the Clintons' words, not ours. Humanitarian bombing of Operation Allied Force carried through NATO, destroying Yugoslavia. And no one in the media was willing to call out what was wrong with the scenario we were being given on that. And our new Cold War with Russia begins with Bill when he reneged, as you mentioned, on the agreements between Bush and Gorbachev, hence starting a new tensions between the countries. And he conducted bombing in Afghanistan and Sudan, his pharmaceutical, you know, factory, but it wasn't making weapons, had no relationship whatsoever to bin Laden, and lots of people killed. The escalation of terror in Colombia because we were supporting the death squads there in the drug war. No one questions him. So it doesn't matter what crime against humanity you create, even genocide, killing of children, the Clintons will never be held accountable for anything, and nor the Bushes, nor Reagan. And this is just a disgrace by seeing these sociopaths in power. Your thoughts, please.
Well, I'd like to broaden the discussion. What you said is bad enough. Strategically, when you look at how we and the Russians look at what the old Soviets used to call the correlation of forces, okay, this is what's important right now. During this period, let's say 91, the big Desert Storm victory, after that was over, General Wesley Clark, who had been NATO Supreme Commander, visited Paul Wolfowitz, who was deputy head of the, or was in the head of the high position in the Defense Department. And he said, Paul, great victory, way to go, way to go. Now, what's the main lesson that you learned? And Wolfowitz said, oh, the main lesson we learned was we can do these things and the Russians won't stop us. Whoa. That's 1991, right? Now, fast forward to 2003. We want to invade Iraq with the British, okay? Could we do that? Yes, we could. Did the Russians stop us? No, they didn't. Why? The Russians were just pretty much on their back from what we had done to them by exploiting their resources and cavorting with their oligarchs during the previous decade, and Putin was just getting his act together. That was 2003. The Russians didn't do anything. Now, fast forward to 2008, which I recounted before, the beginning of the attempt to get Ukraine into NATO, and then finally the coup in Kiev on the 22nd of February 2014. What did the Russians do? They stopped us, okay? So it's over. There's no more free lunch for U.S. Forces in that area or in any other area. Because, as you probably know, Putin and his military do their weaponry development in a very much sensible way, more sensible way than we do. We do it through contractors who compete and charge us lots of money. We do it with people who advertise undoable systems like knocking missiles out of the air. The Russians watch what we do. And they spend about a tenth of what we spend in figuring ways to get around and about, okay? Now, what happened was that we got out of these treaties, but the Russians were prepared. And now the correlation of forces is no longer in our favor, more so since there's a virtual military, and I will say that with emphasis, there's a virtual military alliance between Russia and China. And if you go back to the 70s, when I was watching the Russians and the Chinese, this is 180 degrees away from they used to hate each other. Now they're driven together by the imperial wishes of the United States, and we have been stopped. And the earlier we recognize that, the better for all. Because the only way we can do this kind of thing and keep the world safe is to work out things by compromise. Now, I mentioned, let me just one more thing here. I did an article on Sunday on the anniversary of October 27th, 1962. What happened then? That was the middle of the Cuban Missile Crisis. And there was a Soviet Navy captain. His name was Vasily Arkhipov. And he needed to give permission to a commander of a Russian torpedo submarine that had a nuclear weapon, nuclear torpedo on it. He wanted to fire at the USS Randolph in the Caribbean, and he had already given the order to do so, but Arkhipov said, no, we don't have orders from Moscow. Rather, we will surface. Now, they thought that World War III had started, but when they surfaced, they realized that it had been avoided. What am I saying? I'm saying that if it hadn't been for this one Russian Navy captain, Arkhipov was his name, who decided to play by the book on this very sensitive, delicate thing like nuclear weapons, okay? If it hadn't been him to countermand that order, you and I probably wouldn't be doing this talking today, because the U.S. did not know that nuclear tip torpedoes were on these Soviet submarines. They didn't even know where the Soviet submarines were, not all of them anyway. And if the USS Randolph and its accompanying destroyers had been knocked out by a nuclear missile, the only assumption could have been that it was fired by one of those medium-range nuclear missile emplacements already in Cuba. And that was, of course, what JFK said would be the reason for a full-scale attack on Russia, on the Soviet Union. So what I'm saying here is that we're very close to that kind of thing now. Nobody seems to realize it. The warning time, if you used to be 30 minutes, now if these medium range ballistic missiles are reinserted into Europe and Central Asia, the warning time would be down to 7 minutes. And 7 minutes is not enough. If there's a false alarm or if there's something, some people like Arkhipov that could intervene. So people don't realize this, but to the degree that we make relations with Russia and even China, even worse, the likelihood is that this kind of thing will lead to the demise of us all long before global warming gets the rest of us. That just needs to be brought front and center, because it makes no sense at all to tweak the nose of the Russian air.
I appreciate those insights. Thank you. I believe that it will not be a military in the sense of planes and missiles. I believe that China, Russia, and Iran have developed technologies that would enable them to turn off our grid. Now imagine the chaos if one day, for right in the middle of a day, all of the electricity went off. What would happen to nuclear power plants? What would happen to streetlights, subways, airplanes? And we're not dealing with an unsophisticated China now. We're not dealing with Mao's China. We're dealing with the second largest, about to become the largest economy in the world. We're dealing with people who have a hard time smiling in the Politburo in Russia and in the People's Party, the Communists in China. Not a wise decision. We should be looking to have some peaceful signals sent out instead of constantly threatening. My last question for you, and you have 12 minutes to answer this. I want to go through some of the important WikiLeaks releases and just show people how salient, how timely these were and are today. I'm also going to include some of the work of Max Blumenthal put it in perspective why he was probably arrested. 2010, Chelsea Manning's release, Iraq War and Afghan War Documents, 700,000 classified documents, over 251,000 diplomatic cables, and 482,000 Army reports. They revealed that the video of the Apache helicopter you mentioned in the last hour attacking and killing a dozen civilians in Baghdad. Also, Pakistan's intelligence support to the Taliban. We were giving several million dollars to Pakistan, and they in turn were supporting, and still to this day are supporting, the Taliban. And we continue to tolerate that. Another U.S. Marine incident of indiscriminately killing 19 unarmed civilians and wounding 50 more. U.S. authorities' failure to investigate hundreds of reports of abuse, torture, rape, and murder by U.S.-trained Iraqi police and soldiers. The documentation that the U.S. military killed more Iraqis than it was officially letting the U.S. media know, downplaying those killed in drone strikes as well. Saudi Arabia's Abdullah repeated urgings for the U.S. to attack Iran. The U.S. operating a secret intelligence campaign targeting the U.N. leadership, including Secretary General Ban Ki-moon. Then in 2007, the U.S. Army manual for Guantanamo revealed the concealing of prisoners from Red Cross inspectors and incidents of harsh treatments, torture. 2009, over a 500,000 pager messages within a 24-hour period around 9/11. 2009, widespread corruption of U.S.-backed Afghan government by President Karzai. 2010, video of U.S. helicopter firing and killing civilians. 2010-11, State Department cables redacted became known as Cablegate, including U.S. secret drone strikes in Yemen, spying on U.N. representatives, pushing Saudis to attack Iran, and information about Putin in Russia revealed U.S. use of diplomats as spies. 2016, stolen a 2016 email from the Democratic National Committee, and 2000 from Clinton campaign manager John Podesta in the emails. Other leaks, Israelis bluffing about Iranian threats, Fatah's warning of Israeli invasion of Gaza, program dubbed Vault 7, UK government working with CIA to hack Samsung smart TVs to turn them into microphones, which they have done. 2017, 20,000 hacked emails from Emmanuel Macron's campaign in France revealed lots of backdoor issues regarding Brexit. Now, Max Blumenthal, he is the founder of Gray Zone News and Commentary site in 2015. He's a fellow of the Nation Institute in New York City. He's a former writer for the Daily Beast, Al Akbar, which is in Lebanon, Media Matters, and Alternet. He is the author of Goliath, Life and Loathing in Greater Israel, and as well as Republican Gomorrah, Inside the Movement That Shattered the Party, and the 51-Day War About Israel's Occupation Against Gaza in 2014. He reported on conditions of Syrian refugees in the Syrian civil war, the relationship between the White Helmets and Al-Qaeda and Al-Saud militant groups, U.S. involvement in Yemen, influence of Christian right in U.S.-Israeli politics, Islamophobia in the Tea Party, American media consolidation, federal immigration enforcement programs on Mexican border, Operation Streamline, Russiagate. And he doesn't believe Russia meddled in U.S. elections to have made any difference in the presidential election, and the Venezuela coup and Venezuela's Colombian border clashes. Now, those are just some of the things he's done. Now, when you look at what he reported Chelsea Manning reported and what WikiLeaks released, little wonder then that they are public enemy number one. Your final thoughts, and you have about 7 minutes.
Okay. Well, with respect to Max Blumenthal, he and some other young folks like Aaron Matei are carrying the ball now. They're really doing a terrific job, and no wonder that Max was wrapped up by the D.C. police on orders from above and jailed for 2 days this past week on trumped-up charges, no pun intended. The deep state is really upset by credible reporting, whether it's about Venezuela, whether it's about Syria, or other hotspots where Max has reported very reliably from. So, you know, there's the old portion in the Hebrew scriptures about the handwriting being on the wall. Well, the handwriting is on the wall. When you can take somebody like Max Blumenthal for no real reason, and keep him in jail for a couple of days, and then charge him with some spurious charge. Well, that shows what will happen to the rest of the people who try to spread the truth around. I'd like to go back to what you had said about cyber. Now, the cyber genie is out of the bottle. Stuxnet, which was the virus or whatever you call it, the germ that was developed jointly by the United States and Israel, was what destroyed the centrifuge. Actually, it's physical destruction of the centrifuges in Iran. Now, I want to tell your audience how that came to be. In 2007, there was a honest and courageous leader of an estimate on Iran. And he went back and looked at all the evidence, and the conclusion, which they released in November of that year, 2007, was that Iran stopped working on a nuclear weapon at the end of 2003 and had not resumed work on that weapon. Whoa! That was a bombshell. Who described it as a bombshell? Look at George W. Bush's memoir. That's what he said. And he complained. He said, you know, this deprived me of the military option. For how could I authorize U.S. forces to strike the facilities of a country that the intelligence community says has no active nuclear weapons program? Bummer. Bummer. Now, has the U.S. intelligence community gone back on that judgment? No. That was one of the ways that they got that agreement, the so-called Iran deal, 5 or 6 years ago. Okay? Iran is not working on a nuclear weapon, but the Israelis continued to insist that we were wrong and they were right. So there was an idea that we had to assuage, that we had to pacify the Israelis. And so we persuaded them, please, don't start a dust-up with Iran. Let's work out a way where we can destroy their centrifuges, and we won't get into a war. That's the genesis of Stuxnet. It was a way to buy off the Israelis by starting a cyber war, the first one in human history, okay? So what am I saying here? I'm saying that you have to look at all the motivations behind this thing. And it was ridiculous in the extreme when the U.S. intelligence community itself was saying that Iran was not working on a nuclear weapon to buy off the Israelis, to make sure that they didn't start a war with Iran, because our politicians would feel necessary to get into it, that we buy them off by starting, and this is the real thing here, starting a cyber war to destroy, physically destroy the centrifuges in Iran. That's how it happened. And so the Russians have been trying to convene an international conference where we talk about cyber war, and neither Obama nor Trump have seemed interested in this. And I can't understand why. If they really want peace, as you point out, Gary, this is really, really a volatile situation where you could shut down some systems, including ICBMs or submarine-based ballistic missiles. So this needs to be worked on. If there were a desire for peace somewhere in our government, someone would force that through. But they're preoccupied with so many other things of much lesser consequence that it's not going to happen anytime soon.
Think of it this way. China is currently building the largest city in world history. It will contain more or less 140 million residents. They are bringing people where there's a juncture of three provinces together. They're going to have the largest under-roof center in the history. This is not about a football field. This is about the size of a small city under-roof. They have to accommodate people for living, working, a high-speed rail system, and then they're extending that out to other countries, 67 countries and counting as we speak, both on the ocean building big, they're building a road system across these countries, including Iran, and then increasing their employment and giving them loans. It's going to run them around more or less $15 trillion when it's all said and done. But what we're seeing that is unbelievable is China is building at the rate that we've never seen in human history. There is nothing in our entire history that can compare to it. I'll give you an example. They have built over 100 phantom cities that can hold over almost 180 million people. And people thought, well, that's strange. Why would they build a city and nobody goes to it? And it's out in the middle of, you know, the boondocks. Because now those cities are filling up. And it kept people working and kept people getting an income. They also control the banking system and the shadow banking system. But also, they can build an entire skyscraper from beginning to end in 2 weeks. We couldn't even get a permit in the United States for under 2 years, let alone build it. So if they can do that, if they're doing things no one's ever done technologically in history, imagine the number of people that they have now working on breaking every code in the United States, being able to implant their malware in all of our computers and systems, and then imagine where they have no sense of a moral equation towards human life as being sacred. The Uyghurs, they have imprisoned and taken them into detention camps or harvesting their organs. And this is an open story. This is not something closed behind walls. I even interviewed some of the people who were released from these camps to tell us what actually went on. Plus, they have a Muslim camp they're detaining Muslims in. So these people don't play games. They don't smile. They go by dictates. And whatever the Politburo decides or whatever their communist party hierarchy decides, that's what they're going to do. So I believe there could be tens of thousands, even hundreds of thousands of people working in the technical area. And boy, will we make a mistake if we think that somehow we could beat them in a conflict. It would just be disaster. So I hope that doesn't happen. Ray, thank you for your insights today. We really appreciate them, and I'm sure people in this audience also have gotten a lot of insights they wouldn't have otherwise had.
Most welcome.
Ray McGovern worked in the intelligence agencies for decades, worked under seven presidents through the CIA, and now is a major peace activist and a whistleblower, and willing to be one of those coming forward to tell us the truth. I'm Gary Nall. Thank you all for listening. And have a nice day.
Hey, what's up now?
Brother, what's up?
This is a good recording, man.
Yeah,
I can dig it.
Stop right on.
What's up?
Hey, man, what's your name?
What's up?
Get down and think.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Yeah. Father, father, we don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate.
You know we've got to find a way
to bring some love and get here today. Oh, picket lines and picket signs. Don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me so you can see,
sister,
oh, what's going on.